To welcome to those who are watching us online through our live stream, welcome. So this morning is a special morning. A new rhythm that we established in a Sunday in January is the fifth Sunday. And so there are about four fifth Sundays in the year of 2017. And so every fifth Sunday, we just kind of want to create a space to just spend some time worshiping through music, through prayer, through hearing stories of how God is moving here at New Life. And so this morning, that's what we're going to be doing, worshiping God through music, prayer, and celebrating and reflecting what He has done. And so we're going to hear about the 85 years of history at New Life, about our Indonesian fellowship. And so it's going to be a really a good time worshiping God for what He's done. So I just want to invite you to stand at this point. One of the things we believe here from the Psalms is that we worship God through music. We worship Him with our whole lives. But music is a special way for us to gather and to give God the glory for what He has done and what He will do. So let's worship Him together.
Good morning, everybody. I'm going to invite you guys to sing with us. The song's called Cornerstone. If you believe God is strong, if you believe God is the cornerstone of our faith, would you sing it out with us? So Lord, we come to You now and we worship You. We lift our voices to You. We give You worship. We give You glory because You're worthy of it, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Sing it with me, church. My hope is built.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness.
I dare not trust.
I dare not trust. Trust in Jesus' name.
Would you sing that again with me, church? My hope is built.
My hope is built on nothing less.
You sound good.
Than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest prayer.
The holy trust.
Righteousness alone,
faultless to stand,
faultless Jesus.
Thank you, team. Have a seat, folks. I'm out of breath, and it's not even my asthma or my allergies. It's great worship, so thank you. Hey, last week I introduced our new board, but I failed to install and ordain them. So in 85 years, that's probably not the first time a pastor has forgotten something, and so I'll just continue in that tradition. But let me bring up the new board at this time, and I think they're all here. Come on up, Jason, Jacob. You were just here. Oh, there he is in the back. Veronica, there you are. Okay. Again, folks, even as we think of celebrating the past 85 years, it is wonderful as we step into the new year to know that we have three new folks who are stepping up to lead us in helping me to stay on track as we are new life for the city. And so let me just share. Scripture teaches us that those chosen to the office of elder or deacon are called to encourage spiritual growth among the members and help them to walk in the way of Christ. Scripture also teaches that by bringing together the offices of pastor, elder, and deacon, we continue to fill the ministry of Christ in our day. We work together as a team, leaning into the gifts that God has given each of us, to which have been affirmed by others, from you, the congregation, from the current board, for us to carry out these offices, and again, to make an impact for our city. And so the board has affirmed, and we now present to the congregation, Jason, you can raise your hand, Jason. Jason and Veronica to fill the office of elder, and Jacob Van Gelder as deacon, and that you may know of their willingness to accept these responsibilities, I am going to ask them to answer the following questions. So, do you reaffirm the vows that you made when you confessed your faith in Christ and became a member of this, his church? Do you believe in your heart that you are called by God's church and therefore by God to the office of elder or deacon? Do you believe the books of the Old and New Testaments to be the Word of God and the perfect doctrine of salvation, rejecting all other doctrine? Will you oversee and encourage the spiritual growth of the congregation? And do you commit to strengthen your own spiritual journey, as well as doing what you can to help bring us the good news of Jesus to our surrounding communities as we are new life for the city? Okay, as I again pray for these folks and install them and ordain them, I encourage you, if you are willing, just to go ahead and extend your arm as your way of saying, I am a part of this, I am praying for these people. And so let's pray. By the authority given to this, his church, by our Lord Jesus Christ, we ordain you as elders and deacon in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord, you have called these leaders to this office. Thank you. Enlighten them with your spirit, strengthen them with your hand, and so govern them that their lives and labor may be to the glory of your name for the advancement of your kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. And God's people said, amen. Thank you for coming back up. I'm going to invite Rachel up now. Rachel's going to share with us some exciting opportunities for us as a church.
Thank you, Juno, and good morning, everyone. My name is Rachel Lohman. I'm one of the associate pastors here at New Life, and welcome. We are so glad that you're with us on such a special day as we celebrate and remember some of the wonderful things that God has been doing in and through us, his church. So first thing, if you're a guest today, first or second time guest, we are so glad that you're here, and we would love to be able to connect with you, to get your name, to have a way to follow up with you and stay in touch. So we have a Get Connected card. It's right inside of your program here on the left side. And if you just fill that out and take it to the information tent, which is right back out in front of the lobby, the same doors you came in after the service, someone will be there to exchange that card for a gift that we have for you, just to welcome you and say that we're glad that you're here. So if you're a first-time guest, make sure that you do that. We'd love to get to meet you. So I get to recap a couple of really cool things that have gone on here at New Life and also share some upcoming ministry opportunities that we have. First one being yesterday, we had Keep Artesia Beautiful, which was an awesome day. It's something that we partner with about six or seven other churches in the area through the Shalom Project. And our mission is really to bless the city, to let them know that we, as followers of Jesus, are going to do something about that. And we are going to partner to restore and beautify our city. So as you see some pictures here, we had about 80 volunteers come out from all over the city. We had Whitney High School students. We had people from other churches, people of all ages. We painted the roller rink, planted new flowers, painted some benches there at Artesia Park. So it was just an awesome day. If you were part of that or volunteered your time, thank you. We are making a difference in Artesia. So also, as you'll see in some of those pictures, some people were wearing New Life t-shirts. And since we did baptisms in those a couple of weeks ago, we had people asking where they could get one. So today we are continuing to sell some of our New Life t-shirts. This is a little cute one. Don't worry, we have bigger sizes. So we have some of our New Life t-shirts and also the coffee mugs. So the t-shirts are $15 for adult sizes back at the information center. And we also have mugs for sale too. So moving right along, we have another great opportunity to serve if you want to be part of what God is doing through us in the community. We have our annual post office food drive, and this is one of the huge ways that we collect canned goods that stocks our food bank, which we serve about 150 families every Saturday morning through that. So we are in need of volunteers to help sort the canned goods that we get from the post office on Saturday, May 13th. And there are different time slots that you can volunteer in pretty much all throughout the day. So if you want more information about that or you want to sign up, please see Ryan. And lastly, the Her Story Women's Conference is coming up. It's less than a week away, so it'll be next Saturday, May 6th, and we've got a little video to watch.
Just as we see through the narratives and testimonies in Scripture, there is power when we not only identify the hand of God moving and working in our lives, but we also have the ability to communicate it to others. I'm Stephanie Becerra, Bible teacher, author of Revolutionary Women Who Dare to Say Yes, and co-pastor at Rancho en Español. And I'm excited to be a part of an amazing group of conference hosts and speakers who are bringing to Southern California her story on May 6th in Artesia. I will be joined by Reverend Liz Testa from New York, National Leader for Women's Transformation and Leadership for the Reformed Church of America, an amazing communicator of the Word and has a unique testimony to share with us. Rachel Lohman, Associate Pastor at New Life Community Church in Artesia, whose passion is helping others discover how their personal story intersects with God's grand story. Writer, speaker, and creative Ariel Astoria will be joining us as well. She has an original spoken word piece that she prepared just for the women at Her Story. We personally invite you to join us for an amazing time of Bible teaching and equipping you to unlock the power of your testimony. Come out to Her Story on May 6th.
So we are really excited about that. We've got just over 100 women who've already signed up for that. So today is the last day that you can get your ticket in person, the last day. So if you want to come, if you want to invite your friends, daughters, granddaughters, whoever, I would love if you could join us on that day. So you can go out at the information center and sign up. You could also sign up online today too. And that is $25. It includes lunch, $20 for students, and I believe we have a few scholarships available left if you're interested. So at this time, I'm going to welcome up some special guests that we have with us. As some of you have heard for weeks leading up to Easter, our special Easter offering went to a local nonprofit organization called Margaret's House. And Margaret's House does some amazing work for women and families in our community. And so we are going to hear firsthand from them today. I'm going to welcome up Chrissy, Becky, and Amber to share with us. So let's give them a warm welcome as they head up here.
Good morning. My name's Chrissy. I'm the executive director of Kingdom Causes Bellflower, and it is just an honor to be here and worship alongside of you guys this morning. I also just want to thank those of you through the Roots small group study. We met several of you, at our Saturday morning breakfast and showers, and also several of you came to Margaret's house, which is our small family hospitality home, which we're going to be talking about this morning. So thank you for taking the time to actually spend time with us and build relationships. That was amazing. So I'm just going to tell you briefly about Margaret's house, and then I'm going to introduce you to Amber, who is a friend of ours who went through the program. And this is also Becky, who's our director of housing programs. We'll stick around after. So if you guys have any more questions, we could talk to you then. Margaret's house is very special. It is a small, beautiful home in Bellflower. And so when you hear shelter, you think these big, like, industrial buildings. This is a beautiful home, and you wouldn't even be able to pick it out of the neighborhood. And it's tucked in by a local school. And the reason why that's so important is because if you are a homeless family in this area of LA County, there are not a lot of places for you to go. So often kids have to get uprooted and taken to downtown LA or other parts of the county, which means that they're not going to their school. And there's already a lot of shame that happens with homelessness. So we started Margaret's House as a way to help local families stay together and also to help women and parents, fathers too, who are getting custody of their kids back, but the only reason they can't get it back is because they don't have a place to live. Margaret's House counts. And so with that, I'm going to introduce you to Amber.
Hi, I'm Amber. So I was homeless on the side of the 91 freeway in Bellflower, and Kingdom Causes, who is part of Margaret's House. My caseworker came to pray with me one day, and the next day I went to jail, which I was not arrested, I was rescued. And from there, I went to a program, and my daughter had been adopted. I had been away from her for 12 years. From the program, I went into sober living, and by the grace of God, I got my daughter back. So she came to live with me at the sober living, which I wasn't quite comfortable with, her being around people in newly to recovery. So I talked to my caseworkers. They got me into Margaret's House, which is beautiful. It was within walking distance of her school. They helped me. They helped me with budgeting. They helped me. I got a housing voucher. I have been successfully housed for 2 years. In a beautiful apartment in Downey. And my daughter was struggling with her grades. When I first got her back, she had gone through a lot of changes. She had D's and F's her sophomore year. She has almost straight A's this year, her senior year. She's graduating in 30 days. She made Long Beach City College cheer team. We are just, Margaret's House, I don't know what I would have done without them. So whenever they ask me to come do something like this, I do it because this is me giving back and this is what God would call me to do. Thank you.
Thank you. So if you guys have any questions, what's unique about this is there's only 3 families at a time that we work with, and we have a front house with a chaplain family who actually grew up at New Life, Tim Bauer and his wife and kids. They're up front, and so it's not a shelter. There's not cots. It's a beautiful home, and I would like to see more of these throughout Southern California because shelters are not places for kids and for families. So I encourage you to pray about that and try to find other ones so you could support them as well. If you guys are interested in learning more about Margaret's House, how you can get involved, we really, really value mentoring and relationships. And so that's what was such a blessing to us when I talked with Pastor Mark about the Roots program, that you guys were not just wanting to do handouts and just do flyby volunteering. You guys wanted time to build relationships. And that's the key right there. So if you're interested in that, please let us know. Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you so much. You can stay up here for a second. So with our Easter offering that we collected for a couple of weeks that was benefiting Margaret's House, we are so excited to be able to present you with a check. This is what you've raised, New Life as our church, to Margaret's House for $5,115. So there you are. Thank you so much for being here with us, ladies, and for the work that you're allowing God to do in and through you. And thank you to New Life. I hope that that encourages you to see that your generosity is not just filling out an envelope and putting a couple dollars in, but you're actually having a life-changing impact in people's lives in our community. So thank you. At this time, we're going to join together in prayer. So go ahead and bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, we are humbled and honored to be able to worship you in your presence today, God, with your people. And Lord, I'm just so thankful for organizations like Kingdom Causes and Margaret's House, who are being the hands and feet of your son Jesus on the streets of our community, Lord. I pray a special blessing over Margaret's House and the work that they're doing, and for those who are in need of rescuing, who are still out there, God, help us to be your eyes. Help our hearts to break for the things that grieve your heart, and help us to do something about it, God. Lord, as we celebrate 85 years today of your faithfulness to New Life Community Church, God, we are reminded that we are not here for New Life. We are here for you. And that you must always remain our focal point, God. I just thank you for the faithfulness that you've extended to this church, your church, over the past 85 years, God. For the healing that's happened, for the growth, for the leaders you've raised up, for the miracles that we've been able to witness, for the ways that your spirit has moved, and for the ways that we hope to be making an impact in our neighborhoods. God, I pray the words of the psalmist as he wrote, that your faithfulness has extended to all generations, God. Help us to grab hold of that, Lord, for the next 85 years and 100 years from now, God. Help us to look back and see only the hand of your faithfulness strengthened all the more, God. I pray that our priorities and our vision for the future, God, it would be so in sync with what you would have us do through this community, Lord. That we would be in unity with you, God, that we would be sensitive to hear your voice, your vision, and that we'd be humble enough to listen. Lord, we give you our hearts, our hands, this church. Have your way. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. At this time, we're going to continue worship through the collection of our offering. If you're a guest with us, there's no obligation to give. But if you consider New Life home, this is one of the cool opportunities that we have to partner with God and what he's doing through our resources. So I'll go ahead and invite the ushers forward at this time.
Church, I want to teach you a chorus real quick. It goes like this. And I love you in response, 'cause you love me, 'cause you love me. And you could sing that with me when we get there. Sing with me. God is so good. God is so
I love you in reason.
you love me. He loves me so, if you believe that this morning.
He loves me so.
He loves me so.
He loves me so.
Is our response to him for his goodness. It goes like this.
I love you because you first loved me. I am yours because you kept pursuing me. I love you because you first loved me. I am yours. I am yours.
It's our response. Sing it with me, church. I love you.
I love you because you first loved me.
Yes.
I am yours because you kept pursuing me. I love you because you first loved me. I am yours. I am yours.
Sing it again, church. I love you.
I love you because you first loved me. Pursuing me, I love you because you first loved me. I am yours, I am yours.
Sing, I am yours. Yes.
I am yours, I am yours.
I am yours.
I am yours, I am yours.
Last time, would you sing it as a prayer response?
I am yours.
Thank you, guys. Good morning, New Life. I'm Ray Vandermorn, and I've been asked to take a few moments this morning to share with you a little bit of our 85-year history. To do that, you got to find an old guy to do that, as well as how New Life has impacted my life and family. I've been part of New Life for 65 years. And I know that some of you, several of you, have a much longer history than that. I know my wife's family has been a part of this church since 1936, and some of you even longer. So it's not just my story that I'm going to share, it's our story. From the minutes that are in our church archives, written in Dutch. Actually, they were written in Dutch until the early 50s, which is kind of amazing to me. From that, we learned that on April 11th, at the organizational meeting of the Artesia Reformed Church, which began meeting in the Artesia Women's Clubhouse with 55 adults and 7 young people, it was decided that those who would be present at the first communion service would be considered charter members of this church. And some of you are direct descendants of those folks. At that first communion service, they took into membership those that had joined after the organization, and the church at that time had 83 confessing members and 82 baptized members. That morning, 14 made confession of their faith. The others transferred from some of the other churches in the area. And they also formed their first consistory, which we today refer to as our governing board, and elected and installed four elders and four deacons. Again, some of you are direct descendants of those names. When a major earthquake hit and destroyed the women's clubhouse, they continued to meet in a barn. And I've heard stories from some of the old saints that have now gone before how they would worship, and the chickens were running around and under the benches while they were having church. After the earthquake settled and they kept meeting in the barn for a while, a new building was built in 1933 on the corner of Arlene and 186th in Artesia, at a whopping cost of $2,289. Following World War II, my parents and I was 15, immigrated to the United States and settled here in California and in this Artesia area. The reason we came here in 1951 was because there were a lot of dairies. This was dairy country, and there was work here. And so there was a place to begin a new start, which, again, as I think of it, my father was only 20 years younger than I am today to start a new life in a new country. This church, by that time, had grown to 225 families, and most of them were second and third generation Dutch. And as I told you before, they still operated in a Dutch world. Sermons were preached in Dutch. Sunday school did become English, and after a while, they decided it really was time that we go to an English-only church. And that happened in that 1951-52 time frame. At that time, 40 families left this congregation and started another Reformed church that continued to preach and minister in the Dutch language. My parents attended the Dutch-speaking church because they didn't speak English. They'd only been here a few months, and I attended with them. But as I said, I was 15. I was now a high school student, a freshman. And though I couldn't speak a lot of English, I was starting to pick up, and I wanted to be more immersed in an English community and an English-speaking area. I remember when I first started working for my uncle, when we first came here, my aunt one time complained because she heard me say some English words that were not appropriate. My uncle's job was to teach me English. So he lost that job real fast. And she was glad to hear that in May, we arrived in May, and in September I started high school. A friend of mine that I met at Excelsior High School, where I graduated, introduced me to New Life Church, or Artesia Reformed at the time. And he invited me to go to church with him. And that's my first introduction to this congregation. It had a lot of young people. That was attractive to me. The fact that there were a lot of pretty girls didn't hurt. And so I loved going to church on Sunday evenings with Nick And it was an exciting time, particularly for me, coming out of a rather rigid church atmosphere, a rather rigid worship style, to come into a church that was filled with young people. There was great music. There were a lot of hymn sings. There was excitement. I felt welcomed, even though the guys still called me a greenhorn. I felt at home, and it has been my home ever since. I eventually also found one of those pretty girls. And after one of those Sunday evening services, I finally had the nerve to ask her if I could take her home. And the rest is a part of a 60-year history. In 1956, the Reverend John Hibma arrived. And the church continued to grow. And it was time to make a decision and expand. And so the decision was made to take the existing building that was on that corner of 186th and Arlene and to donate the building to the Nazarene Church, who was looking for a church home. They could just remove it from our property, and we would build a new, larger sanctuary, which seated 600. And so we remained on the same corner where we started. In 1964, Reverend Lehman arrived. Meanwhile, in 1963, and towards the end of Pastor Hibma's tenure here, I was had the opportunity to take a position with a company that I had been working for, and the only company I worked for, to open a new store in Escondido. And so we as a family, Florence and I and our three young children, and she was pregnant, by the way, moved to Escondido. Now, Escondido at the time was a retirement community. It was gray. And the new church that the Reformed Church had started was just beginning. It was a new church start, and we were the only family with little kids. Our kids had a lot of grandparents while we were there. But we had a very difficult first couple of years while we were there. We buried a child. Florence, who had recently been diagnosed as an insulin-dependent diabetic, became very ill. And so there were a lot of difficult days while we stayed involved in our church and trying to develop a brand new business. But this church always stayed connected to us and we to them. They were our prayer support. That first year when we gathered to bury David, no one knew us, not even in the church that we had just started attending. So it was, we really supported and needed the support and appreciated the support of this congregation. They kept us going, and something that we will always be grateful for. I was only 28 years old when they asked me to join their church board, and I was ordained an elder. And so we had an active life in Escondido. But in 1970, I had an opportunity to take a position in our corporate office at the First Martin Final that I worked for, and we would return back to this area. And we had a great plan. Florence and I decided we spent 7 years in Escondido. We really got to enjoy a new church, a new church start from scratch. I liked the kid. It's the first time I realized that Methodist Baptists were also Christian, because all I ever had been around was a Reformed church. I didn't know anything else, so I assumed every other Christian was Dutch. So that was a growing experience for us, one that we cherish still today, because God was at work. So our plan was that when we came back to this area, one thing was for sure, we would not attend Artesia Reformed Church. We would visit, we would check it out and say hi to everyone, and then we would start a search of another church that would be more fitting and a little bit more open and diverse for us. That was our plan. God had another plan. One Sunday while we were there at worship, and as we were leaving the door, one of the side doors, kind of trying to sneak out so not too many people would get you, because after all, they were all wondering, are we going to stay? This elderly lady approached me, or approached both of us. I think we were both at the door at the time. And she very sternly lectured me how we needed to be a part of this church. And I said, we haven't made a decision yet. She said, yes, you have. This is where you need to be. You have experienced a new church start. You've experienced worshiping and ministering in a different, totally different area. And that's what we're going to do, because this church is moving and we need you to be part of that. And to me, that was God's voice speaking to us, and we stayed. We became involved. The church, in participation of their upcoming move, because they had bought this property, which was a former dairy, started a lay movement program. For those of you that are not familiar with it, lay movement was a movement in the 70s where lay people would come and visit your church. They would teach the Sunday school classes. One of the lay people would bring the message, and there would be an altar call. An altar call in a Reformed church was unheard of. But we did it. And it, one of the songs that we occasionally sing here today is part of that movement, or at least was really used a lot, and it's called I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. As our oldest child did at that service. She went up front for the altar call and accepted the Lord. In 1970, the church's decision was to again reach out to a growing community and change their name to New Life Community Church and build a whole new facility and leave Artesia, downtown area. The building is still there. It's now the Methodist Church. So every time you take a trip downtown Artesia and pass the Artesia Methodist Church, that was our last building that we built. And we moved over here and started a new project. Here we are. We became involved again. Florence in women's ministry and music and in social events to reach out into the community. I was on the board and search teams, various administrative tasks. I've had the privilege of being part of a part-time part of the staff from time to time. The church grew in attendance, was now at 1,200 in Sunday school and in multiple services. It was a growing community and we were a growing church. The preschool was started. The Indonesian outreach began. But after many years of growth and several staff changes, we faced a declining membership and financial shortfalls. It was very difficult. At one time, our attendance dropped to 200. We, like many of you, went through difficult times, very painful decisions. But God remained faithful, and He brought us the servant team and new leadership. And we began the process of refocusing on how to remain relevant in a changing community and a changing time and a changing culture. Change is difficult. 44 years in corporate management, I've seen my share of change. It's not easy. And it's painful at times. Our church has changed. Some of us had to give up things that were very dear to us. Don't forget, so did our parents when their church changed. I know my mom and dad didn't think much of hymns, because to them, the only music that was appropriate for church was the Psalms. So change is not new to our generation or the generation before us. But we as a church wanted to become more open, caring, and reaching out to those that needed a place to belong. That's what you were to me in 1951, a place that I could feel where I belonged. New Life remains to be one of the most diverse congregations in our denomination, even today. However, for the next generation, that's right, particularly right here up front, for them to continue this ministry, they need our support. They need our prayers. They need our help. Now, I know some of you and many of you are like me. At times, it's a little difficult to figure out where you can still fit in and what you can still do and what your energy will still allow you to do. And it is difficult for me that I can't be part of or keep Artesia beautiful. I don't have that kind of energy left. But there are other things that I can still do. And I'm reminded that God, all through my life, has always put people in my life that were supporters, that were encouragers, that lifted me up and helped me move on and continue in my ministry here and my life. And I'm reminded of one gentleman in particular when I was on the consistory at Escondido Reformed Church, the new church start. We were forming a new board. I was one of the elders, and we were interviewing some folks. And a gentleman that was probably even older than I am now, I'm heading for 82, and I think Mr. Crowley was about in that time area of his life. He was a retired executive for Procter & Gamble. He had a beautiful estate with wonderful grounds that he would open up for our young people to spend time at, and a pool. And he had a lake on his property, and in the lake was a little boat, a little rowboat that he had tied to a pole, and it would kind of bobble in the lake. And when we asked him if he would join the church board and become an elder, as he had been before in the Presbyterian church, he said, "I can do that. I will do that, but I don't have the energy that I had when I served on boards in the past." You know, he said, "It kind of reminds me of the little boat that I have on my lake. It's tied to a pole. It's a tether, and it can only go as far as the tether allows it to go. That's where I am in life." And he said, "I will do all that I can as much as my tether allows." And I think I've taken a lesson from that. So allow me to encourage all of you and myself to stay connected as much as your tether allows. Encourage our staff, pray for them. And when change becomes difficult for you, put your focus on the Lord and on opening your heart, so that we can be a witness for this community, widen the doors, so that all who seek him can find a place to belong. Put your focus on Galatians 5:22. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace and patience, kindness, goodness, and faithfulness. May God continue to find all of us faithful.
I am so sorry. Good morning. My name is Marcelo Lalopua. I am a member of the Indonesian community, Indonesian congregation of the New Life Community Church. I thought Pastor Ricky was gonna open up first, but I guess I'll give you guys my testimony first. They asked me to tell you guys what I've seen the whole year that we have merged into the New Life Community Church. I have several parts here. Individually, I've experienced a tremendous amount of growth by learning to step up to lead when needed. The chance for me to lead here in the interim of the worship coordinator position being filled, that was a tremendous experience for me. I've learned spiritually I learned that God does his best work whenever we step completely out of our comfort zone and let go and let the Holy Spirit work within our worship, our everyday life. As a member of the Indonesian community, I see that we have also become an even much tighter community now. And I also see that our brothers and sisters within and also from outside of the New Life Community Church care about what's going on back home in Indonesia, and that they care also about our mission in Indonesia. And I see how much support that we are getting for this mission, especially with our upcoming mission trip in the summer. And also, lastly, as a member of the New Life Community Church, I see that the world is now a much smaller place than we originally think it is. As we all have come together from all kinds of different ethnicity and backgrounds to push forward with our mission in building and introducing the kingdom of heaven to all of our brothers and sisters in the world.
Okay, thank you, Marcelo. Yeah, hi, I'm Pastor Ricky, the Indonesian pastor here at New Life. For me, having our Indonesian fellowship merged with New Life was God's answer to all the prayers of my former Indonesian church in Downey, the church that I lead before coming here. It was not easy to take the decision to merge with another church, especially since that church has spent 25 years in fellowship together. We have been praying long and hard about the future of our church. We also prayed for the future of our children who have been born into the American culture. We had to choose whether we want to continue to survive as an ethnic church or join other churches, especially in American church. For 25 years, we tried many times to join other churches, especially other Indonesian churches, but we always failed to. There was no common ground. The answer to our prayers to merge with New Life was also in God's time. God's miraculous way. This is a miracle to us. We never thought any American church would invite us to join or merge with them. Moreover, they were willing to accept and support our mission and service in Indonesia. 11 years ago, God's servants from my former church and New Life Indonesia got together at, I remember, Mr. Simon Tarigan's house with the sole purpose to merge, but the meeting came to a dead end and we couldn't agree on anything. 3 years ago, our intentions to merge was still a work in progress that also came to still a dead end. Why? Because I know sometimes God's plan is not always in accordance with our plan, but God makes everything beautiful in his time. Amen? The fact that we merged on April 3rd, 2016 is all in God's plan and not the plan of us humans. As his servants, we choose to obey his lead and see his blessings flow on New Life Indonesia. There are many things in the past year of merging that God did for us. Not only did New Life Community Church itself gain 72 people, but within a year of this, we also gained 9 new members to our Indonesian fellowship who also decided to join and become an official partner of New Life. We also baptized 2 young children, and we will still continue to grow. I'm thankful that in the past year, more and more Indonesian members have become directly involved in New Life main worship service, like Marcelo said, with the worship team and to be greeter and other ministries. We also had more people join us for our Friday night prayer meetings. There we pray for Sunday services, pray for all those serving in New Life, and we also pray for the staff. We pray for all needs of New Life. We pray that the presence of New Life Indonesia here can be a blessing for New Life. I'm also grateful because 36 members of our congregation want to participate in Rooted Experience. All of them were wonderfully and extremely blessed by participating in community. They all individually witnessed their growth in God and also in each other. They become more active in serving and their commitment to the church increased. Their lives are changed. From this Rooted Experience, three people decided to become members of New Life. We also gained at least four New Life group facilitators. For me, this is, again, extraordinary. Through Rooted, we are all getting closer to each other and increasingly loving each other. They also recognize that through Rooted, they receive new knowledge about God and also experience new things. So again, we are so thankful to be a part of New Life. Our hope and our prayers with this merge is that we will come together hand in hand, expanding the kingdom of heaven on earth in this city, and also, of course, with the support of our mission in other parts of the world. Our hope is with this partnership, we can reach more people for the Lord Jesus, including many people in Artesia and our surrounding areas who are also followers of Jesus. But we also want to reach wider and globally, supporting other missions. And then I feel the Holy Spirit's movement here, and it's going to bring this church to be a bigger impact toward the city, country, and worldwide. Thank you once again for becoming major supporter of the mission in Indonesia. Please continue to pray for our mission trip on June 16 to July 2nd. This is the first mission trip for New Life after the merge. Pastor Ryan, Giovanna, and I will lead the team. We will have 12 people in total. We will visit two orphanages in Indonesia. Psalm 127, first and the second verse, says that as a church, our house or the family of God, our family development does not and should not depend on the greatness of a pastor, the intelligence of the congregation, the church's wealth, or other matters. It is clear that development and the laying of our foundation relies on God, who is the owner of our spiritual family and church. We can plan all kinds of things for our church, but if we work using only our own ability, then all will be in vain. Failure will be the only thing waiting for us if we do not rely on God's guidance and His permission. However, we need to not worry if we let God be present in the development of our church and family, because He will guide us through His plans. If it was not God working during the merge between my former Indonesian church and New Life, human effort would have not succeeded. There were and still will be challenges, for sure, tears, sharp pebbles that sharpen our spiritual senses, tests, struggles to get to where we are now and where we want to be. But now this, God's mighty hand lead and help us before the merge, the year after, and will continue to do so forever with our prayers. Today, April 30th, 2017, I look back and reflect on what God has done for us in our lives. With joy, there is only one thing we can say today. Thank you, Lord, for what you have done for us through this merge. Thank you for your miracles. You have strengthened all our ways, purified our hearts' motivation, and you have been present and walked beside us. And you have answered our prayers. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for you are the owner of this church. Let us be your hands and feet and eyes for the rest of the congregation here, for the city of Artesia and the surrounding city, for Indonesia, for America, and for all who need your light. Make us be even more rooted in you, to love you more and to be your faithful servant. Thank you.
Thank you. the splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God!
Morning. All right, good morning. You can be seated. My name is Ryan Clement, and I'm the Student Ministry Director here at New Life Community Church. I get to work with our middle school and high school students, and I've been here for just over 6 years now. And it's crazy to look at my life and think that I've been nowhere for that long. I've always moved, you know, different schools, different things. And when my wife and I came here, actually, she was my girlfriend at the time. We've since gotten engaged, gotten married, popped a kid out, and, well, she did more of the popping. Anyways, sorry, that's a little too much information. You know, when we started here, there weren't a ton of students, and there weren't a ton of young people. And so we've had the blessing, the privilege, and the challenge of really being New Life to this diverse community and reaching out to the students. And to be honest, when we showed up and found out that this church was this old, I thought, there's not a lot of churches that old that are still growing. Most of them are dying. And so this is so awesome to be here 85 years later celebrating how we are growing and learning to love this community. So thank you all for being here. When I showed up, there were just a few students in the congregation, and these four were all students in my very, very first youth group gathering. Brandon, I think you were in eighth grade. Yeah, eighth grade. Jonathan was a senior. And then these guys were sixth graders. They were the same height back then, too, which is crazy. They're seniors now. And so I've had the joy, the honor, privilege of knowing these six awesome guys, being a part of their life, seeing them grow. And did I say six guys? We've got to leave room for the Holy Spirit and myself. I'm talking about myself. Come on, guys. You know, these four awesome guys, seeing them grow. And so I've just invited them to come up and just share a little bit about how being at New Life has been a blessing and how they've seen God work. So, Brandon, take it away.
Hi, guys. My name is Brandon Poo. And hi. I think I might repeat a little bit of what was said before regarding, like, the history of our church, but I already wrote this, so I'm just going to stick to the script. So, so one thing I really love about New Life is our spirit of outreach. Since our founding, our church has been focused on being a welcoming environment for more than just its own people. In 1932, we started as Artesia Reformed Church, and our services were held in Dutch. And then in 1955, we switched to English in an effort to reach out to people outside of that specific community. In the 70s, we changed both our name and our location to what you're all familiar with today. So obviously, I wasn't here to experience any of that, and I did plagiarize all that information from the partnership booklet, but what I want to say is that the effects of our history are clearly present in the church right now. If you look around, there's such a beautiful and diverse picture of the body of Christ. Within these walls, we have so many different cultures, ages, ethnicities, and backgrounds, and it all just fits because we share one thing in common, and that's the love of Jesus Christ. That alone is crazy to think about, because if it was back in the old days, we were all Gentiles and we wouldn't get any of this stuff. But luckily, we're like grafted in and whatnot. But I have loved being a part of this church, and specifically the youth ministry. Every Wednesday night, I get to see New Life Community Church really live up to its name. Each and every student is welcomed with open arms, no matter where they come from. And having that mentality has produced so much fruit in the community, which has become like family. And I have been blessed not only to be a part of that family, but to help students come to know God through it. And along the way, God has especially looked out for me. I remember back before I was in high school, in eighth grade, my mom started praying that I would have a role model in my life. And that was the exact year that Ryan came to our church. And since then, he has been the older brother that I never had. And he has helped me become the man I am today. And if you ask me, I think he did a pretty good job. So, on New Life's 85th anniversary, I just want to celebrate our longevity and our continued focus on bringing people into not only our community, but our family. I hope that we keep that mindset for the next 85 years and well beyond that. Thank you.
So good morning. My name is Jonathan, and to some of you, I might be known as just the short Asian guy that plays guitar on some Sunday mornings. To other you, I might be known as Callum Patty's son in the back, but I've been here for a while. That's really weird to say. My parents enrolled me at the preschool here when I was 3 years old, and I've been coming ever since. So when Ryan asked me if I could talk about the impact that New Life has had on my life, I said, oh my goodness, there's no way I could do this in 90 seconds, but I'll give it my shot. I'll give you my best shot. When I think about the impact that New Life has had in my life, I think of two things. I've narrowed it down to two things, and it's opportunity and relationship. I say opportunity because I had an amazing chance to grow up in the church through the preschool, through the Connecting Kids program, through youth group. I was given the opportunity to play up here on Sunday mornings when I was in high school. It was through those things that I was really able to find a foundation in my relationship with Jesus Christ, and I was able to find my identity in Christ as well. But also going past that, after I graduated high school, after I started college, I was really able to take my faith to the next level. I was able to come back and work for Mandy and Tina at Connecting Kids. Bless their souls for letting me work for them. I was able to come back as a youth leader and lead worship with Ryan and Ryan Melchor. It's also where I met my girlfriend, Dafia. I don't know if she's listening or not. And through that, I was able to be a part of the Indonesian ministry, which has been a huge blessing in my life, just getting to play in the band with the guys and getting able to just sit down and have lunch every Sunday. You know, it's been awesome. And moreover, I was able to come back at 9:30 services and to play in a worship band with professional Christian musicians from the industry when I was just some kid that taught myself how to play guitar and really had no business being up here. I had, through those opportunities and through growing up here, and even just through getting coffee after a 9:30 service and getting to know you, I was able to find relationship in each and every one of those things. I was able to find mentors, people that were going through the same processes and steps with me through life. And so to say that New Life has really impacted my life is really an understatement. It's home for me. It's what I know, and I've been to other churches, but I just really want to affirm you guys because what we have here, you guys are so welcoming, so loving. You guys have seen me grow, and I've had relationships with each and every one of you, and you guys have all had an impact within my life. So I wanted to say thank you, and I wanted to encourage you guys to continue to be who you are so that you can carry that on to everybody else who steps foot into this church. So without you guys, I have no idea what my life would look like. I have no idea who I would be today or what I would be doing. I'd probably still be playing baseball at some JC or something like that. I don't know, but yeah, just thank you guys so much for everything.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Caleb Volpe. Thing one, that tall kid, Phyllis's grandson. And for the 18 years I've been alive, I've been coming to this church. With the occasional visit of my mom's deaf church, it was in Norwalk and it was a beautiful church, but this is my home. This is where I grew up. Growing up here, I've learned so much and I've met so many incredible individuals and so many incredible people. I've grown with God and I've grown spiritually, and with these mentors, I've become the man I am today. Along my spiritual journey, I've been blessed to go to a church that believes in spiritual development of our youth group, or our youth in general, from ages little, young babies from the nursery to high school, and even there's a college group as well. A young kid like me in sixth grade, going into the, you know, the tough years of life, going into high school, having a mentor that was there for me to have a cup of coffee with me, just to talk about life, to grow and have lunch with on occasion. It's just been so influential on my development, having someone there for me through those tough years. And high school has not been easy, and I'm graduating, so woo! But without the involvement of my youth group and my church, I don't believe I could be the man I am today. I was able to grow as a follower of Christ, and I was willing to step out and be who I am and be a Christ-following individual. I'm also a big believer in service. And I like sitting in the service, and I like youth backstage as well. But I remember when I was younger, growing up in the church, my grandma used to make me sit in the service. And she'd tell me, be quiet, don't talk. And then after church, we'll get something to eat. And I'm a big boy, so that was motivation for me. So my grandmother and my Aunt Arlene, who are also here today, they also have been here a very long time, and they've been coming here with me since, also my Aunt Shirley's here too, and my Aunt Dina. So they've all been coming here longer than I've been alive, and growing up here with them has been super awesome too. This has been one of the best experiences I have ever had as a person, coming to church on Sunday and Wednesday night youth groups or any excursions that the youth group may have. I have to say that church is not an escape, but it's home. It's where I feel loved and at peace. The weeks and the days can go long and they can get rough. And so Sunday morning with God is what I look to. So, happy 85th birthday, New Life. And I pray every day for many years to come that we will continue to grow and outreach to the people of Artesia and communities surrounding. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jordan Volpe, Thing 2, Caleb's brother. Children in general grow up in specific physical, social, cultural, economic, and historical circumstances. Their socio-cultural environment is what most will call it. Excuse me. All of which that influenced their childhood. As we all know it, these influences can push and pull you in different directions of life, good or bad. We all grow and mature in different ways and phases in our life, places. We all embrace certain things. Some are more difficult than others. And my life is no different. Growing up in a world with no father is a difficult thing. Thinking, walking around the house and just thinking, why is he leaving? Not going to play catch, shoot some hoops, go fishing, and if you're feeling really adventurous, burn a little ant with a magnifying glass. You do miss out on those things, but what you really miss out on is someone to give you truthful and honest advice about how to be a man. And these are things that we did achieve and get in our lives, me and my brothers. But not from men, but from women. My Aunt Arlene and Phyllis, my grandmother. These are the most important women in my life. These are the people that taught us how to be men. Thank you. Mind you, my grandmother and her aunt, and my aunt, I'm sorry, grew up in a household of all women. So it's a contrast of both worlds. We're growing up with all men, I mean all women, and they're growing up with all women too. So how are they going to teach us how to be men? And the answer is this. Men of the church. Men of the church. The most important thing about that is if you have any questions about how to be a man, you can come to people like Ryan, come to people like Mark and Pastor Juno, and even occasionally, women here can really teach you how to be a man. And growing up, you don't think of church as being a real blessing until you get older. Don't you agree? My life could have went in so many different directions, left or right. But having a place to look forward to every week is a blessing in itself. To be able to grow in a positive place, positive culture, with people around you that are growing in God's image is another blessing in itself. These are places that I go to that help me grow, like the food distribution, the youth group, lunch with Caleb and my grandmother. This church has been around for longer than my lifetime, and that's for sure. That is for sure. This church, though, is still new. It is still full of life. And it will always be new life for the city. Thank you, and happy 85th birthday, new life. You still look 25, that's for sure. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, gentlemen, and Caleb and Jacob. Even though you're taller than my daughter, she's going to Indonesia with you, you still can't date her. So, my phone rang during the service. I don't know why she calls me. She had just finished her run. Half a marathon, 13.1 miles. Say, Dad, I finished. I'm like, I'm in church. And that's her way of raising support for her to go to Indonesia. And so I was thrilled to hear she made it. I said, you can walk. She goes, walking is not an option. That wisdom will come with age when she realizes that. But people, hey, thank you for hanging out here. We'll be leaving in a few more minutes, so hold on for those potty breaks. And let me just say, you know, we've heard stories about our past, our present. And we can certainly learn from our past. We do that in our families. We do that in our businesses. We do that in our church. And so we have remembered God's faithfulness through the good times, through the difficult times. And it's in our past, while we honor it and remember it, it is critical for us not to worship it. It's critical for us to worship the God who has brought us through all of this and who has sustained us for 85 years. It is critical that we lean into God's spirit as to what may happen to us as we continue to be new life for the city. Some things will never change. We are always Easter people. You know, we heard it at Easter, you know, from Romans 6, that we have died with Christ and we have risen with Christ and that we are Easter people. We talked, I think it was 2 years ago Easter, we talked about we are new creatures in Christ. The old is gone, the new has come. Some things will never change as we are followers of Jesus. The reality in the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus doesn't change, and that is our hope, and that is what we hold on to. And while the good news never changes, how we live that out, what we do with that, has to change. Otherwise, we can all go on hospice and just close the doors. But our methods may change, and you have been through, you know, I'm going to say you, the older folks who have been here for 60 and 70, some of you 80 maybe years, you've seen those changes. As Ray said, you have been through the change. You know that change needs to happen. And if it didn't happen then, we wouldn't be here today. And so no matter what our changes are, and I don't know what they're all going to be, I don't have a crystal ball here to say, poof, here's what we'll be doing in 5 years or 10 years. What I do know we will be doing is that we will continue to be intentional with community, entering into the community at large and with one another any way we can. Because if we're not intentional about being in biblical community, it won't happen. Because we all just get a little bit too busy and there's other things to do. We're going to be intentional to continue to be a church that lives out our faith in action, that it's not just happening within these walls, but that we are missional. That's probably the new word again for outreach. We're missional. You don't need the pastor to be at your house to invite your friend over to have lunch with, where you can just build a relationship, hear his or her story, and eventually, when appropriate, share your story. You don't have to have the pastor there to do it, and Lord knows you do not need to be within this church, because if the only place ministry happened was this church, it just wouldn't happen. Life happens outside these walls, and so does mission, and that's why we partner with Margaret's House. We can't, you know, do that ourselves, but we partner with Margaret's House. We partner with the city of Artesia when they again ask us, hey, can we use your chapel for the National Day of Prayer? And the board says yes, because we want to build that relationship, not just to be in relationship, but to somehow, some way, build the relationship so that we can be new life to the city. And we'll continue in the future to try to be intentional to equip moms and dads, aunts and uncles, grandparents, and you to have your home as a beacon of light for Jesus. To have you in whatever authority level you're at with kids to be the disciple makers of those kids and not think, oh, the best person to pray with my child is the pastor. The best person to have a conversation about deep things is the pastor. No, the best person to spiritually help your child grow is you. You're, as a grandparent, as an aunt and uncle, as the people who you are in relationship, it all comes back to you being equipped. And so how that looks like, what it looks like, I'm not sure of any of that. But I'm sure that we're going to be venturing into and continuing to lean into those three areas. Now, I think many of you heard this past Wednesday that Pete Herrensma passed away. Now, 88 years old, bless his heart, he always sat in the back, and he will be missed. And I went to visit them this past Monday at the home and walked in, and like I usually do, I'll introduce myself. Pete knows who I am, but I don't know what kind of meds he's on and if he'll recognize me. And so, hi, Pete, this is Pastor Juno, your favorite pastor. He gave me that big smile like he always does, and he's probably thinking, give me more drugs. But we visited, and we talked, and I thanked him for his encouragement. And I says, I know at times, Pete. I said, when I was your favorite pastor, yeah, I know you just love all the music we sing and that it's never too loud for you. And I go, so thank you. Thank you for your patience with us. Thank you for your encouragement. And Betty says, yep, and we never left. Because obviously I know at times we're stretching it with some things. And yet here they are. They are a legacy of change, knowing that if it doesn't change, the church will not be here. He retired in his early 60s, and he didn't retire from serving the Lord. I mean, he drove for the home, he drove for the preschool, he drove for the students. He was in, he helped out with our food distribution, and when I would see him there, there he'd be sitting, smiling, trying to unfold a box so we could throw it out in the trash. And his gift was really just his smiles, and he did whatever he could to his last days on this earth. So when he retired, he knew he still had a place in the church to make a difference. And so that's his legacy, and that's really who we are as New Life. They lived out and they fought the battle that we all have to be consumers. Make it just for me, make it just the way I like it. I want it just like this because it's always been like this. But he just hung in there with us. And he served wherever he could with a smile on his face. And as we continue to live that way, as we continue to resist the temptation to make it all about our own personal likes, but as we continue to say, okay, Lord, what about those not here? We're going to continue the legacy of New Life. You've been through a boatload of changes over 85 years, and almost all of it's been for the people not yet here. And so let's not take a comfort seat. Let's not think, okay, we can coach this one out till Jesus comes back. No, let us continue to think creatively, to think, how can I be a part of what God is going to do for this next season of ministry? And I'm convinced, as that happens, that we will continue as we stay in our mission, that we will continue to see a growing number of communities that are marked by reconciliation, peace, justice, and hope. And that is all for the glory of God. And God's people said, hey, we're going to sing another couple songs. So I'm sorry. I don't need to apologize for that. It's been a wonderful, wonderful service here. During this the next couple songs, we have our Change for Christ. That is what we do every fifth month, every fifth Sunday of a month, Change for Christ, which could be checks, dollar bills, or anything else you want to. You can bring them up front while we're singing, drop them in these containers here. And this fifth week, we're going to be giving it and sharing it with those who are involved with global outreach. And so please, as the Lord leads, you can be a part of that. If you didn't bring anything with you, you can go to our app and you can give right through your phone. And so again, let's continue to thank God for his faithfulness.
Would you sing this with me, church? And if you could stand with us as well. Lord, we love you and we thank you for a powerful morning. We want to welcome you in our lives. Sing it with me, church. There's nothing.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord.
Sing it from your heart.
sin and darkness, who love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole world with only thunder, who love is breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. If you know this song, sing along. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done.
Guest, we'd love to meet you outside at the information tent, so we'd love to put a face with the name. Two, we have cupcakes, I'm told mini cupcakes, Ryan, not big ones, mini cupcakes out at the hub, so come on out there, we'll celebrate and enjoy our birthday. Three, Hector in the back here, thank you for joining us today. He's been a great addition. He has some CDs, so if you want to get those, you can pick those up, not pick up, you can buy them at the information center. Margaret's House, thank you for being here, folks. Thank you. It is an honor to serve with you and lead you as we are New Life for the City. So let's go out there, all for the glory of God. Amen. Thank you.